Good morning, everyone. If you could all please take your seats, we're about to start with our keynote speaker. Good morning. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. It is my honor and my pleasure to introduce today's awards brunch keynote speaker, Jerrod Delaine, who is the Chief Executive Officer of Legacy Real Estate Development. Jerrod Delaine is a decorated scholar with degrees from Florida A&M University School of Architecture and Environmental Technology, as well as a Master's of Science degree in Real Estate Development from New York University Schack Institute of Real Estate. As a seasoned real estate developer with over a decade of experience, Delaine has amassed a uniquely diverse skill set that includes design, construction, finance, and asset management. Delaine spent the first 5 years of his career at Forum Architecture and Interior Design. His efforts focused on managing affordable housing projects in the southeast region of the United States. He then parlayed that experience into the role of Director of Development at Carthage Advisors, a Black-owned Harlem-based development firm. The Carthage business model concentrated on preserving and developing affordable housing in the metro New York area, where the typical financing instrument was low-income housing tax credits and tax-exempt bonds. As a firm, Carthage developed expertise in HUD-RAD transactions capitalized by LIHTC financing. In this position, Delaine led crucial asset management for acquisition rehab deals, where acquiring existing properties and performing tenant-in-place renovations is both an art and a science, when maintaining the quality of life during the rehabilitation phase is of the utmost importance. Delaine led negotiations with tenant association leaders, community organizers, and general resident meetings. After 8 years as development director at Carthage, Delaine joined Donahue Peoples III to build Legacy, a value-based company committed to utilizing access to capital markets and improving communities through real estate finance and development, where he is now the CEO. Demonstrating his lifelong commitment to education, Delaine continues to serve as an adjunct professor at his alma mater, NYU, and Pratt Institute, educating both graduate and undergraduate students with an aptitude for development, public-private partnerships, urban economics, and portfolio management. With decades of experience defined by various awards and accolades, amassed through 3 degrees and countless prosperous acquisitions and developments, Delaine is regarded as an authority and thought leader in urban housing policy. Please join me in welcoming him for our keynote speech.
Good morning. Let's see if this thing works. Wonderful. Good morning, everybody. My name is Jerrod Delaine. I'm the CEO of Legacy Real Estate Development. And the theme of today's discussion is, how will we empower communities? Right? Young people, take notes. We're going to be covering a lot of important information today. Right? So, So, Legacy Real Estate Development, briefly, is a value-based company that we use capital to improve communities. We raise equity, we raise debt, we create relationships with banks, investors, to do what we do, right? Sometimes that's using LIHTC, sometimes that's using HUD products, sometimes that's using just traditional conventional loans. It's exciting, I love it. Building a building is a difficult task. Building a building with government finance is a little more complicated. Building a building with government finance in urban communities is even more difficult. But to see a family move into a home, is honestly a truly fulfilling life experience. Also co-host of a podcast called The Intelligent Developers, and the idea behind that is talking about this from our perspective, right? Talking about how we do this from our perspective. And what we've come to realize is there's people around the country that have that same burn, that same feeling of, what can I do to change this community? These things are happening around me and I feel powerless. How do you do that? And not everybody has the ability to go to an expensive university to find out how to do it. So we're creating different pathways for individuals to learn how to do that, right? I'm also a board member of a number of fantastic nonprofits that are working in a similar light. Father, three beautiful girls, a husband, a son, a brother, you know, so on and so forth. So that's a little bit about me. You know, firstly, I want to say, you know, I want to thank God. I want to thank my wife. I want to thank my family for the support system I've had. You know, my parents have created a situation where I feel like I can do anything I want to, right? Anything I believe in, I feel like I can accomplish it. And part of that is this empowerment conversation. How do we create that space that young people from these communities in New Jersey have a platform that they can go off and be great, right? Housing being a pillar of that, right? And all of us in this room have the ability to do that through policy, finance, title, insurance, brokerage, construction, right? Development, you name it. All of us in this room have the ability to have that impact. How can we all do this better? And I think everybody in this room can, you know, reflect and say, man, it's not that easy to do what we're looking to accomplish. How can we make that easier? How can we make that better? How can we improve that? Right? Next slide, please. Right? So, my life is tremendously impacted by faith, education, entrepreneurship, and real estate. That's how my life has been impacted, right? And I think if we do those four things, and we think about it and we work on it, these will all move us in a positive direction. And that's in particular my life. And I'm not saying your life is gonna work the same way, but I think some of these will leave clues. A developer once told me, you know, success leaves clues, right? So, you know, talk about my family for a moment and then we're gonna jump into the theme, right? So my father's family, you know, I'm blessed, honestly. My family owned real estate, which is a rare thing. So I come from a black family that owned land in Alabama. Alabama, one of the states with the worst education system, with one of the highest levels of poverty, my family owned property. And as a young person, as I got older, I saw the difference between my life and the others that did not. I saw that my family had a foundation that they were able to supply for us, right? They also cared about education, but we had a foundation that helped me and my cousins, you know, in the generations after me, it helped set us forth in a path that actually, you know, seems to be moving in the right direction, right? My mother's side is actually a little similar to most of Black of America, right? My grandmother lived in public housing, right? My mom, she lived in that public housing for a moment. All of my mom's sisters lived in actually the same public housing complex. It's called St. Francis Homes in Meridian, Mississippi. Every single one of my female cousins on my mom's side lived in that exact same housing project at some point in life. And a number of the generation after me at some point lived in that exact same public housing complex, right? There's been a generational impact on our family. And that's a very similar depiction for a lot of Black Americans. Right? How can we help break the cycle of poverty? And that's something all of us need to work on, right? And you Google me and you look up my story, a part of my drive, a part of my story is I see that. I see, oh, like if with the right foundation, this is how things can go well. And I also see like, man, the struggle, the hardship of not having the proper support, of not having quality housing, on living in a high poverty community, going to an underfunded school, living in a high crime neighborhood, how that's gonna impact the children, how that's gonna impact the family structure. I've seen that unfortunately firsthand, right? So I've seen both of these. This is how I grew up, in seeing kind of both of those dichotomies happen. How having a family, my dad's family actually was very much faith-based. So my grandfather went to church every single Sunday. He was a deacon. My grandmother was a deaconess. And then he went to church with the fancy hats every single Sunday. My grandma was that woman in the front with the fancy hat. We were that. Again, we own real estate, right? And, you know, it's not only did they go to church every Sunday, but we went to church every Sunday in the church that my grandfather built and his father built, right? So I come from a family of builders. Again, I saw like this. I saw like, oh, like, it wasn't foreign to me to be what we now call an entrepreneur, right? I grew up with a grandfather that was an entrepreneur. That is a pretty rare Black experience, unfortunately, right? Both of my parents went to college. That's not a common trend in African American, you know, even today, right now, right? My grandfather, for a moment, taught at a university, Miles College in Birmingham. That is a very rare African American experience, unfortunately, right? Again, different experience. I was watching both of these growing up, how having a home, having faith-based, cherishing education, and on the other side, which is a picture very similar to a lot of Black America. And the experience I was seeing my cousins go through in Mississippi is the same experience I saw people go through in Miami and Atlanta and Cleveland and Trenton and so on and so forth, right? Unfortunately, it's a very similar story of not having the right support system, right? Next slide, please. Right? Faith. I'm a Baptist Christian, and I'm not saying you should be a Christian, but whatever you're believing, I think it is a great foundation for a community, right? So I'm a member of Abyssinian Baptist Church, and I actually once heard Pastor Butts say, you know, religion isn't perfect, but what it does give you is a moral compass, right? And as a community, if we all have a similar moral compass, it's one of the ways to help us, right? It's not the only way, but it is a way to build community that you're not alone. And one of the issues we have in our communities is that a lot of people are struggling with the strife that's going on in their communities and not having a foundation, right? And obviously there's other religious sects that do a similar thing, that it creates a bond in the community, right? It creates a place to come together. You have a hard week at work, you can come together, right? It's actually similar to therapy, right? You get to come together and it's actually healthy for your mindset. That is, in my life experience, that's been healthy, right? And I joke with my wife that my mom says I should go to church more, and my wife says I should eat salad more, and I think they're both right. Although I don't do either one of them enough, or as much as I should, I'm smart enough to know, like, yeah, they're telling me something that's good for me, and if I do it more, then my life will probably have a better outcome, right? So I think faith is an important part of communities, as well as, you know, it's healthy for your overall mindset. It bonds people together in happy and sad times, right? When there's a death in the family, you have a community that's there and supportive of you. When you get married, there's a family that's there and for you. When you build a new apartment building in the neighborhood and, you know, they need to connect to the community, right, and have outreach to the community, you know, faith-based organizations have been a pillar and are a pillar in communities. And today, you know, if you go through a lot of urban communities, you know, faith-based organizations, churches have a lot of the real estate, right? They have a vested interest in the health of those communities. We should be facilitating that and helping them being an active part of the growth in those communities. And if you look back in history, if you look at civil rights in America, the faith community was a pillar of that, right? It facilitated that in times where that was difficult. Right? Real estate, the other important pillar, you know, again, I was blessed that I was born into a family that owned real estate. I think home ownership is important. I think affordable housing is important. I think we don't have to choose, right? That we can do both. Now, there's lots of programs for affordable housing. Well, let me not say a lot. There's some programs for affordable housing, right? LIHTC being the most successful one for new construction. We don't have a lot of programs to create home ownership. We should be working on that. That creates a nest egg in that community, right? So that you live in that community and you plant in the community gardens and you go to the school board, you should enjoy the economic health of that community as well, right? So we need to work on that, improving the neighborhood, as well as we need to create housing for those who need it. As we all know, we're in a housing crisis right now. We're not producing enough housing. And you know, we need folks like you in this room who help create policy to incentivize us to create more housing, right? How to help us rehabilitate the existing housing stock to preserve, you know, they mentioned earlier, I used to work at this firm called Carthage, and our business model was preservation for a while. Our whole business model was purchasing buildings in urban communities, revitalizing them, and preserving and stabilizing those homes. We need to do that too. But we also need to be building more housing for the next 22-year-old that graduates from college. How do we keep that person in that neighborhood, right? How do we keep that young, talented person from Trenton University, you know, or from Rutgers, you know, who says, no, I want to move back to Newark. How do we create housing that they can come and plant their families in those neighborhoods instead of taking those resources and moving somewhere else, right? So real estate, which most of us in this room, you know, practice as professionals, you know, this is an important part of communities, and we need to continue to support that as well as creating space for the next generation, right? I spend a lot of my life doing education at this point, and I'm a big believer that, you know, we train up the next generation to step up and do what we're doing, hopefully do it better than us, right? Next pillar, education. My family, my mom and dad in particular, were incredible proponents of education. I learned from a very early age that education was important and I didn't really have an option. So from about elementary school, it wasn't a matter of if I was going to college, it was a matter of where I was going to college. And you had to pick one. I also had a joy of my father went to Miles College in Birmingham. He pledged Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity, which I'm a member of. And my mom pledged Delta. So as a young person, I was able to see these African-American professionals socializing, having a good time. My dad actually still goes to homecoming almost every year, still. So as a young person, I was seeing black business people, black lawyers, right? Black musicians, physicians. As a young person, that was normal to me. And I was seeing them socializing with my parents. That became a norm to me. And obviously, as I grew up older, it's like, yeah, like I'm gonna go to college. Like that's my path. That's what I'm gonna do. Education is important, and I have no other option, right? So I ended up going to Florida A&M University. At the time, was the largest HBCU in the country. Somehow, North Carolina A&T has passed us, but we still graduate the most African Americans with bachelor's and master's degrees. Still, fantastic life experience. It was a fantastic life experience. I loved it, and I was able, instead of when I was in high school where I was the smart black kid, instead it was like, no, you're just a smart person, right? That you could just learn, right? And just get the education and grow and mature, right? And obviously education has continued to support me through my life, and I try to do that for other people, right? Sometimes that's in a classroom, sometimes that's in a keynote speech, sometimes that's on a podcast, sometimes it's in a book, sometimes it's in an interview, right? Getting the knowledge out there, it served me incredibly well, and I try to do the same for others, right? And the last pillar here, which is entrepreneurship. You know, I'm blessed that, like, I've known entrepreneurship basically my whole life. So a fun story, my grandfather was a builder, his father was a builder, and his father was a builder, right? So I come from a family of construction and building. So literally my whole life, I remember like walking on construction sites and smelling wood, you know, smelling drywall and fresh paint. Like I've grown up in that. Used to pay us like a quarter for like a whole day of like lifting bricks. But entrepreneurship's been, you know, the norm for me, right? And my grandfather met my grandmother at a salon that my family owned. So my family, so it's nowadays they call it bougie. So my family was that family in town, right? So they owned the salon that was on the main street in this little small town in Alabama. So my grandmother was a beautician. So my grandfather, he did construction during the week and he was a barber on the weekends, right? He had multiple streams of income. Met her, obviously the rest is history, right? So entrepreneurship has always been something that I've seen as like, oh, like that's a path in life. And that you could provide for your family while doing that path. I ended up going to architecture school got my first architecture job. And I was working in essentially entrepreneurial shop, basically, in architecture. And literally 2 months into it, the boss there, one of the bosses, he used to do these side projects that were like too small for the overall firm. So I got my first entrepreneurial experience 3 months into my first job out of college. So home extensions, and this is 2003, 2004, 2005. So Florida was like doing these crazy new construction stuff all over the place, and condos and timeshares, and it was pretty wild. And I was getting my first taste of entrepreneurship on creating value, managing your time, right? Managing billable hours, marketing, promoting. I was getting like a little taste of that early in my career. Fast forward, I go and get my master's in real estate development to learn how to do this professionally. And then I work with a couple entrepreneurs where I get to see firsthand how you can have a vision, you can have an idea, and how you can bring that to reality. And in affordable housing, you must work with public agencies to do that, right? You need tax abatements, you need subsidies. Sometimes you get land or a building, right? You work with those parties to do this economic development activity, right? And in real estate, there's millions and millions of dollars that flow through these transactions. So I learned entrepreneurship very young, and as I matured to an adult, I realized like, this is what I wanna do in life, that I wanna, you know, actualize my visions, bring them to reality, you know, provide for myself in doing so. I think we should create that path for the next generation, guys. Right? There's gonna be folks that are gonna come work in public policy. There's gonna be folks that work in planning. There's gonna be folks that work in banking, folks that work as developers, brokers, title, right? You name it. We should be facilitating that growth, right? Helping them build a network at a young age, right? So that as they mature, right, their friend who was an analyst at a bank now is the president of that bank, right? And now they can transact with each other, right? That shouldn't happen on accident. We should be facilitating that. And events like this do that, right? We're all here today because, right, we're gonna network with each other, we're gonna learn something new, right? We're gonna hopefully generate some new business, we're gonna hopefully provide for our families while we're doing that, right? We're gonna reconnect with folks, right? We should be doing that for ourselves, and we need to be setting up the next generation, and in particular, setting it up for neighborhoods that we provide these housing communities for. Right? So again, these are my four pillars of my life: faith, housing and real estate, education, and entrepreneurship. And I'm not saying these are the only way to do it, but in my life, these have impacted me. And I think each of these is a way to empower communities, right? Because truthfully, if we give them the resources, but they don't have the education to do anything with it, right? Or we give them the resources and we don't give them the support system to keep it, right? And they don't have the network, right, to actualize it, right? We're not fully providing for them. We're not truly and honestly supporting these communities. If we're not showing them how to own businesses. I met with a gentleman one time, we were in Brooklyn, and Best Eye Restoration, which is a large nonprofit. We were at a community event, and I was a young analyst guy, and I was like, yeah, I do affordable housing. And he was like, yeah, so like what I do is economic development. And I was like, economic development? What is that? And he's like, yeah, like we need to create jobs in this neighborhood. And I was like, oh, that's important too, right? If I provide housing for them, but they don't have a job, what am I doing? How sustainable is this that I'm doing, right? That all of the above we need to be working on. And obviously we can't do it all, right? We found our corner of this industry where we can do it, but how can each of us in this room empower these communities, right? Next slide, please. So here's my call to action for all of you, right? So when you return home to your loved ones, right, your significant other, your children, your social channels, whatever, I want you to tell them that this guy Jerrod today asked me, how can I empower neighborhoods? And I'd love to see where that conversation leads, right? So the next time you see me at a conference, please come up to me, let me know how that conversation goes, right? If you want to post it on my LinkedIn, let me know how that conversation goes, that this needs to happen, right? And I don't have all the answers, you don't have all the answers, right? But as a collective, we can work together, right, to create positive change. I truly and honestly believe in that, right? And we need to work on it, and variables change over time. So the thing that worked today, 4 or 5 years from now, right, the variables change, right? And we need to be able to adapt, we need to be able to evolve, right, and create a better path. Right? Next slide, please. So I'll leave you with that. How are we going to empower communities? My name is Jerrod Delaine, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Delaine, for those words, and I think a call to action for all of us to ask not only ourselves and all of us in this room, but everyone, maybe even more importantly, who are not in this room right now, what can we do to help empower our communities? And so now I think I will ask our agency heads to come up onto the stage to get ready for the award segment.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests and honorees, welcome to the Governor's Excellence Awards. We are gathered here today to celebrate the outstanding achievements and contributions of your peers in the areas of housing and economic development. As we continue, we kindly request all agency heads and presenters to make their way to the stage for the awards presentation. To begin the award ceremony, please welcome Daryl Godfrey, Chief Operating Officer of the New Jersey Redevelopment Authority, who will open today's celebration.
First of all, good morning. We got to do way better than that. I am delighted to be here today. So, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and esteemed colleagues, welcome to the Governor's Excellence in Housing and Economic Development Award. We are here today to celebrate the remarkable efforts and contributions of individuals and organizations that have transformed communities and driven economic growth across New Jersey. We receive dozens of nominations for these awards, and each and every one we receive resonated with a distinct and meaningful impact on each of their respective communities. Today's award recipients represent a small but mighty selection of projects that have created jobs, impacted lives, and making housing more accessible and affordable across the state of New Jersey. Now, without further ado, I would like to invite Janelle Winter, the Director of the Division of Housing and Community Resources at the Department of Community Affairs, to join us and present the first award of the day, the Leading Neighborhood Revitalization Partnership Award.
It's an honor to be here today to recognize collaborative efforts that have breathed new life into neighborhoods across our state. The Leading Neighborhood Revitalization Partnership Award goes to a project that embodies that spirit of transformation and positive change. This year, we are proud to present this award to Eastern Pacific Development for their outstanding work on the River Grove Family Apartments in Bridgeton, New Jersey. River Grove is a shining example of how collaboration can effectively revitalize and transform neighborhoods, providing residents with a brighter future. Located in Bridgeton, New Jersey, the River Grove Family Apartments project represents a dedication to safe and affordable housing for families. Comprised of 68 meticulously designed units, River Grove is a scattered site project that sprawls across 10 separate parcels on South Avenue, Grove Street, Spruce Street, and Ellis Street. This visionary project is the result of a collaboration between Eastern Pacific Development, renowned for its expertise in affordable housing and community redevelopment, and two esteemed partners, the Cumberland Empowerment Zone and the Gateway Community Action Partnership. As the team from Eastern Pacific Development approaches the stage, let's take a moment to view their acceptance video.
Hello, my name is Hans Lampart. I'm president of Eastern Pacific Development, Brookfield Construction, and EPAC Management. The original concept was started by Gateway Community Action Partnership, the Cumberland County Empowerment Zone, and so they envisioned a redevelopment in this neighborhood. They reached out to me to provide the balance of the development team. So we put together the individual sites, applied for and received an allocation of low-income housing tax credits, which funded the project. So one of the benefits in developing a scattered site project is it has a greater impact on the neighborhood than a single project in a one site development. Throughout this neighborhood, residences have started renovating and upgrading because they see the positive impact that this project has had. So the difficulty in a scattered site project is that this project was actually located in 14 separate parcels. The fact that we needed 14 separate site plans, 14 separate site plan approvals, applications, we opened when the pandemic was in full effect. That proved to be a challenge, and we were able to overcome the financial impact of the delays of lease up. This project has achieved and maintained 100% occupancy. So that shows the stability of the neighborhood. We're starting another project a couple blocks away to continue the efforts of this redevelopment area that we started 3 years ago.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating Eastern Pacific Development for their exceptional contribution to our community. Let's give them another warm round of applause. Our next award category is the Adaptive Reuse Transformation Award. This award recognizes projects that creatively repurpose existing structures, preserving historical and architectural significance while contributing to economic growth and community revitalization. This year, we are delighted to present the Adaptive Reuse Transformation Award to the City of Passaic. Mayor Hector C. Laura is here to accept the award on behalf of the city for their remarkable work on Dignity House. Dignity House is a shining example of how innovative thinking and dedication to preserving our heritage can bring about profound transformation. Mayor Laura's unique project was conceptualized as a response to a real need in the community to provide genuine help through practical resources and services. This would give those in the area facing chronic or short-term homelessness as a result of extenuating circumstances the necessary tools to not just come off the streets temporarily in cases of extreme weather or emergencies, but potentially to find long-term or permanent housing. Through services ranging from individually assigned mailboxes, laundry services, showers, food, toiletries, clothing, periodic haircuts, and special initiatives, all of their efforts are intended to provide emergency services as well as practical assistance. Every individual, no matter the circumstances of their condition, is treated with dignity and respect. Let's take a moment to view the acceptance video from the City of Passaic.
My name is Hector Carlos Laura. I am the mayor of the City of Passaic, New Jersey. Some of the structures that we identify, especially in areas of need of redevelopment, is understanding that some of these buildings are over a century old. The desire was to maintain the historic exterior in terms of the architecture while still having these particular structures utilized. Dignity House was a unique project. It dates back to 1899 with the Linden Hose Company. When I first became mayor, I took the specific building that was going to be used as a development project. I designated it as an emergency resource center for the homeless, somewhere where the homeless can be rescued from frigid temperatures and cold brew. Over the years, we were able to invest in it, create mailboxes. We created showers in order to have individuals come in once a week and take a shower, a laundry mat, so individuals can just come in, wash their clothes, and obviously offices for wraparound services in order to provide the resources and programs necessary if individuals wanted to get off the street. We saw that spark other opportunities with mixed-use projects. We repurposed industrial buildings and had them turn into mixed residential and commercial, with commercial on the bottom and residential on the top, and hundreds of new residential projects all over the city. So it is our goal to preserve our history, to invest in our present and our future, but at the same time to be innovative, creative, and send a message out to developers, investors, that together we can make a city that provides services and is here for all.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating Mayor Laura and the City of Passaic for their outstanding achievement with Dignity House. I'd now like to welcome Oscar Parham, Chief Strategy Officer at the New Jersey Redevelopment Authority, to present the Innovative Economic Development Award.
Thank you, Janelle. It is a pleasure to be here to present the Innovative Economic Development Award. This award acknowledges groundbreaking initiatives that promote economic prosperity, job creation, and sustainable development. Today, we're here to honor Valle Adolfo Wilson Development for their outstanding, yes, we can clap and say that. for their outstanding work on the Hinchcliffe Neighborhood Revitalization Project in Paterson, New Jersey. You can clap. This project exemplifies innovation and economic development and serves as a model for sustainable growth. Hinchcliffe Stadium is a National Historic Landmark, one of a handful remaining stadium structures where Negro League baseball teams played. The New York Eagles, the New York Black Yankees, and the New York Cubans played at Hinchcliffe Stadium, as well as 20 MLB Hall of Famers such as Monty Irwin, Josh Gibson, and Ray Dandruff. Larry Dobby, a Pattersonian, was discovered at Hinchcliffe Stadium before becoming the second Black baseball player in Major League history. Beyond baseball, Hinchcliffe played host to Thanksgiving Day homecoming football matches between the Paterson East Side and Paterson JFK Central High Schools, motor car races featuring legendary drivers such as Ted Horn, Dutch Schaefer, and Bill Schindler, comedy shows with Lou Costello, jazz concerts headlined by the man himself, Dizzy Gillespie, and diamond boxing tournaments. Over 20 plus years with committed citizens, elected officials, various stakeholders worked to preserve Hinchcliffe Stadium. That work came into fruition with a $108 million project, which included Hinchcliffe Stadium's restoration, 75 affordable senior housing units, a preschool, a parking deck, a restaurant and exhibition space dedicated to the Negro League baseball. Hinchcliffe Stadium reopened May 19th, 2023. Baye Adolfo Wilson, the CEO of BAW Development, is here to accept the award. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating Baye Adolfo Wilson Development for extraordinary contribution to the economic development in our state.
Wilson, and I am the CEO and founder of BAW Development. Hinchcliffe Stadium Neighborhood Restoration Project is a mixed-use, affordable housing development project that employs a number of strategies. It has multiple generations, all in the same footprint, housing for seniors. You have a preschool for young children. You have a stadium for sports activities. Hinchcliffe Stadium has had a measurable impact on the economy and will continue to have a measurable impact on the economy. Hinchcliffe Stadium was closed for 25 years. And when I was growing up in Paterson, Hinchcliffe Stadium was the center of culture, sports, and activity. And so it felt like a real hole when it was closed down. The restoration of Hinchcliffe Stadium has provided the local culture to gather in the place that they gathered around for almost a century. So we've really filled that hole and made it active, and it's really been momentum for the community. It was designed to be sustainable during challenging times as well as during good times. The stadium has a creative financing strategy that has all these funding and credits to make sure that even during a hard economic time, the tax credits are what's dominating the repayment strategy. It's a part of the community, and so we're going to lean into ensuring that young people, students, the Paterson Public School District, and the surrounding school districts get a chance to come here in a way that's active, engaging for them, and so that grows with the community.
At this time, I'd like to introduce and have Melanie Walter, Executive Director for HMFA, to the stage to present the Excellence in Housing Development Award.
Good morning, everyone. It's an absolute pleasure to be here again with all of you with the opportunity to present this Housing Development Award. The Excellence in Housing Development Award recognizes exceptional projects that provide high quality, affordable housing options to meet the diverse needs of the residents of that housing. Today, we're celebrating the New Jersey Community Development Corporation, NJCDC, for their outstanding work on the Barclay Place Apartments located in Paterson, New Jersey. This project is a testament to the commitment of the community to create vibrant, inclusive communities for all. NJCDC's newest affordable housing development, Barclay Place, aims to comprehensively address the social determinants of health, creating a healthier community for the residents of Paterson. In partnership with Paterson's flagship health system, St. Joseph's Health, and located only a few hundred feet from the hospital itself, Barclay Place offers 55 units of affordable housing that include on-site wellness hubs on the building's first floor, access to a wellness hub with office spaces for community partners who provide services, including health and wellness workshops, and referrals to healthcare providers. Barclay Place is the first development that's been completed under the State of New Jersey's Hospital Housing Partnership Program. This subsidy program was made possible with funding and support from a variety of partners, including St. Joseph's Health, New Jersey Community Capital, and Enterprise Community Partners. This program has become a national model, and Barclays is the first of its kind completed in the United States. I'd like to welcome New Jersey Community Development Corporation to the stage to accept this award.
My name is Bob Garashi. I'm CEO of New Jersey Community Development Corporation. From the very beginning, we wanted this to be a very special place. We partnered with St. Joseph's Health, as well as Community Asset Preservation Corporation, to build a building that would ensure we could serve well individuals with chronic health conditions. We also built a 5,000 square foot social service suite where we can provide services to individuals and families so that they'll have a higher quality of life. By using the low-income housing tax credit, we're able to ensure long-term affordability. We also did something a little unusual. We didn't make the rents as high as they could be, and that's because we wanted this place to be as affordable as possible, and we think we've accomplished that. True community health is about much more than what happens in the hospital or in the doctor's office. It's really about addressing social determinants of health, of which housing really is the key. And that's what guided us in designing this building, in opening this building, and leasing up this building. This project simply would not be possible without St. Joseph's Health, who donated the land and much more. But we had other partners as well, Community Asset Preservation Corporation, the New Jersey Housing and Mortgage Finance Agency, who worked very closely with us to make this possible. And I think we had a great architect, Thriven, who helped us design and ultimately build a really superb building. We truly believe that housing is healthcare.
Thank you. Please join me in congratulating them for this exceptional achievement in a landmark housing development. Next, I'd like to welcome Ty Cooper, the Chief Community Development Officer for the New Jersey Economic Development Authority, to the stage to present the Excellence in Housing Development Award.
Thank you, Melanie. Thank you. I gotta tell you, the one pet peeve I have about this is all the clanging from them putting the plates down. We are here to celebrate some dynamic people getting awards. And so first of all, give yourselves a tremendous round of applause. And thank you so much, Melanie. It's a pleasure to be here to present the Small Business of Distinction Awards, recognizing the achievements of small businesses that have demonstrated excellence in innovation and a positive impact on their communities. We have an innovator, a food curator, and a food retailer. Today, we have the privilege of honoring these three exceptional businesses. First, and I'm gonna beam with absolute pride, we congratulate Equal Space, located in Newark, New Jersey, for more than 8 years. Equal Space has been dedicated to promoting equity for entrepreneurs of diverse backgrounds, including founders of color, women-owned businesses, and LGBTQ plus enterprises. And this is especially important at a time when all of our rights are being violated. Thank you so much for the work you do. What started as a temporary flex space has evolved into a 19,000 square foot shared facility equipped with a range of amenities. Keep on clapping. Comprehensive programming and valuable resources aimed at empowering founders and small business owners to propel their ventures to new heights. They proudly lead Small Business Week and Newark Tech Week and have collaborated with the New Jersey Innovation Institute to curate enriching programs. Equal Space remains committed to expanding community, striving to be an inclusive hub that champions equity for all. Let's welcome, and I'm gonna say stand to your feet, Equal Space founder, the innovator, the curator, City Medina, to the stage. Woo!
Hey everyone, my name is Medina and I'm the co-founder of Equal Space. Equal Space in its inception was the solution to a problem in our growing city of Newark. There was a lack of access to space for startups and entrepreneurs and small businesses to grow. So the innovation factor really was to find an equitable way to allow community brilliance to have access to a really great space that they can jump and launch their businesses off of. Half of our team here are literally devoted to working with all of our members. And so really even building the team informed by the community has allowed us to help those companies grow, for them to maintain space here. And then it's allowed us to develop more product lines and more solutions for that space. There's not only a wealth gap, there's a knowledge gap in the community. And we seek to really authentically fill that by bringing people who have walked similar paths as them. And some of the people that we brought to speak here serve as not only inspiration, but also blueprints of people disrupting and making it happen. And so community sits at the cornerstone of how I measure my success for this company. It's not profit margins, it's how are my community members thriving? And then how do we keep inviting people into the space? At the center of it all, as the founder, this is the space I wish I had. It's been 9 years of building. We've gone from 1,000 square feet to 19,000 square feet. 9 years, we are now expanding. Equal Space will be developing a brand new campus here in the city of Newark. The larger we grow, the more resources we have to even more commit to the programming agenda that we think moves the community forward.
I love this 80s music playing in the background. One more round of applause for Medina. Next, we celebrate Dry Goods Refillery located in Montclair, New Jersey. There we go, I like the applause. Dry Goods Refillery is a zero waste refill shop in New Jersey's first plastic-free grocery store that opened in 2020, just 5 weeks before the global pandemic. The concept currently operates out of their flagship in Montclair, New Jersey, and allows customers to shop more sustainably for their kitchen and home by reusing and refilling their own containers. That's amazing. With refill shops increasing in popularity every year, This way of shopping is a growing way for everyday people and parents to have a daily impact on the amount of waste they produce without sacrificing quality ingredients for their families. Focusing on quality ingredients in a more sustainable and environmentally friendly supply chain, the shop has saved over 100,000 containers, can clap that one up, from landfill to date, and continues to innovate when it comes to supplying the community with waste-free alternatives to everyday items. Let's welcome their owner, Rachel Garcia, to the stage to accept her award. Ms. Garcia, come on up.
Hi, my name is Rachel Garcia, and I'm the owner of Dry Goods Refillery in Montclair, New Jersey. Dry Goods Refillery is a novel concept, which I really feel like is what makes us different. We're a refillery, which allows our customers to bring their own container and refill everyday items by reusing and refilling what they already have at home. As a plastic-free grocery in New Jersey doing something innovative already, we've really allowed our customers the unique opportunity to reduce their waste through the simple act of reuse and refilling. We've tried to make that as accessible as possible by partnering with programs like New Jersey SNAP Benefits or Good Food Bucks in order to be as accessible as possible with amazing customer service. As a business in the climate change space, it can feel really overwhelming, and what our store allows customers to do is to find a place where they can have an impact just through a simple everyday act. And together as a community, we can save hundreds of thousands of containers of landfill, and they can feel like they're making a difference without feeling overwhelmed. For the next evolution of our business, we're planning to take it mobile. We procured an all-electric vehicle through the state of New Jersey and are looking to take our business into the outer communities in order to reach as many people as possible and show them how simple and easy the act of refilling and shopping more sustainably can be.
I love seeing women dynamo moguls out here. Congratulations, Rachel Garcia. Finally, we recognize 1911 Smokehouse, located downtown in Trenton, New Jersey. If you haven't been, you better ask somebody about this restaurant. They're located in Trenton's historic district. 1911 was created to be the local meeting spot for state workers and locals. Owner Maurice Hallett recognizes it as a place where customers could kick back with great food, and their cocktails are pretty good too. In their 8 years on Front Street, they have become a staple in the local community. From their monthly Community First Friday block party to their work with Meals on Wheels and the local YMCA, 1911 Smokehouse is the community partner that organizations call on when they want to host a successful event with the community. I'm also selfishly gonna say the work you did with us, with EDA specifically at Sustain and Serve, was amazing. Thank you so much for your dedication to that. They have two locations, their flagship in downtown Trenton and their other in Newark Airport's newly renovated Terminal A. They are currently building out their third location in Willingboro, New Jersey. So I like that, three, there we go. Let's welcome owner, entrepreneur, and food curator, Maurice Hallett and his team to the stage.
First Lady, New Jersey Redevelopment Authority, New Jersey EDA, and distinguished guests, thank you for this award. At 1911 Smokehouse, relationships matter and are important. There are three keys to success I would like to share. First, we prioritize partnerships with mission-oriented organizations in the downtown area. Trenton Downtown Association, African American Collaborative, YMCA, NAACP, the Divine Nine Fraternities and Sororities, Jack and Jill, The Lynx, all of whom are invested in the economic development and social impact in downtown Trenton. Second, we are grassroots in our marketing efforts. We can't afford commercial marketing that speaks at our customers. So we use social media to talk to our customers to make them a part of the Smokehouse culture and Smokehouse way. Third, we're uniquely positioned to take care of thousands of state workers. However, we have extended hours on weekends and evenings to encourage people to come downtown as well as engage with our local community. Future looks bright and I'm excited. Through the resources of the New Jersey EDA, Mercer and Burlington County, we have been able to invest and expand our brand and footprint with our new opening coming up in Wellingboro, New Jersey. Things are looking good. We realize that in New Jersey, we take care of our own. Small businesses are important. And in closing, family is very important. I want to thank my brother, my right-hand man, my mother who's always supported me, and then my wife and my three sons that are my biggest cheerleaders in everything Team Howell.
Let's give it up for Maurice Hallett. Next up, I am more than honored to bring up the heartbeat and soul who has been leading DCA so fearlessly, Dr. Kimberly Holmes, to the stage to present the Ronald L. Rice Impact Award.
Good morning, everyone. I'm honored to be here to present the Senator Ron L. Rice Impact Award. This prestigious award pays tribute to nonprofits, individuals, or organizations that have made significant impacts on housing, economic development, or community improvement. Before we proceed with the presentation of this award, I would like to take a moment to reflect on the extraordinary legacy of Senator Ronald L. Rice, in whose honor this award has been named. That's right, it's only right and proper to give honor and recognition to Senator Rice. So let's give him a round of applause. Senator Rice dedicated his life to serving the people of New Jersey, and his impact on our state is immeasurable. With a career spanning decades, he was a champion of social justice, affordable housing, economic development, and community empowerment. He worked tirelessly to improve the lives of countless residents, especially those in underserved communities. Senator Rice's unwavering commitment to housing, economic development, and community improvement has left a lasting mark on our state's landscape. His vision, advocacy, and leadership inspire positive change in New Jersey and beyond. As we present this award, we do so not only to honor the recipient, but also to pay tribute to Senator Rice and his remarkable legacy of service and dedication to the people of New Jersey. It is with great pride that we present the inaugural Senator Ron L. Rice Award to Leslie A. Anderson. President and CEO of the New Jersey Redevelopment Authority. Let me take a moment to delve into her incredible background and legacy of service that has brought her to this stage today. Leslie A. Anderson is the President and CEO of New Jersey Redevelopment Authority, affectionately known as NJRA, a position she holds with immense distinction. She is the only Black woman in the nation to helm an independent redevelopment financing authority, and her remarkable effectiveness has led to her reappointment to this position by four consecutive governors. Under Leslie's bold leadership, the NJRA has transformed urban communities across our state through direct investment and technical support, leveraging nearly $4 billion in new investments. Throughout her career, Leslie's unwavering dedication to serving underrepresented communities has shone brightly. She has been a champion of economic development, affordable housing, and community empowerment, making a profound impact on the lives of countless residents. One of her most notable achievements is the creation of the NJRA Redevelopment Training Institute, RTI, which has trained over 2,000 professionals and received certifications from prestigious organizations. In response to the COVID-19 pandemic, Leslie and the NJRA initiated the Small Business Lease Emergency Assistance Grant Program, providing much needed relief to minority business owners who had not received any other form of assistance. She always says, when they said no, NJRA said yes. This program's success was a testament to her commitment to economic equity. Leslie's commitment to service has not gone unnoticed, earning her numerous awards and recognitions, including being named to influential lists such as ROI NJ Influencers Real Estate, Power Players, and ROI Influencers People of Color. She has been recognized as one of NJ Biz's best 50 women in business and received the Chester Holmes Humanitarian Award, among many others. Leslie's tireless dedication and unwavering commitment have left an indelible mark on our state. And just on a personal note, her pit bull tenacity, when she calls and she wants something done, she will say, Kim, I'm on my way over here, but I need to talk to you about this right now. Get this done, and I'll talk to you later. She has been a big sister, a sorority sister, a champion for economic development. She's been all that and then some. So now it is with great honor and admiration that we present the inaugural Senator Ronald L. Rice Impact Award to CEO Leslie A. Anderson, a truly remarkable leader and advocate for New Jersey communities. Why don't you stand on your feet and give her a round of applause?
Hi, I'm Leslie Anderson, President and CEO of the New Jersey Redevelopment Authority. The best advice I can give is to focus on people, focus on community. We lose sight and diminish our impact when we focus on the number of units built, how much money is in a particular project. All of this drills down to people. People are looking for the opportunity to live better. My largest influencers has to be my family. My mom, who was a community activist, I think she poured that into me, as well as my sister, to grab a seat and help people get on the same page and work together. The award is significant because of who it's named after. Senator Rice was a tremendous and fearless leader in the state of New Jersey, a fighter for those that didn't have a seat at the table. He was one of the sponsors of the New Jersey Redevelopment Act, which created the New Jersey Redevelopment Authority. He was always the person who was raising the issues that people didn't necessarily want to talk about. He remained involved in all that we did until his untimely death in 2003. We miss you, Senator Rice. For this award today, I would like to thank Assemblywoman Angela McKnight, Union County Commissioner Rebecca Williams, and also Deputy Executive Director of the Jersey City Redevelopment Agency, Chris Fiore. I appreciate them thinking so much of me to nominate me for this award. If we keep our focus on the people, everything else we do will fall into place.
It has been, as always, a wonderful, celebratory, and educational 3 days at this conference with all of you. It's so rare to have the opportunity to get more than 1,000 people together with a common purpose and a common understanding
and to enhance that understanding with the kinds of sessions and workshops that we've had here so far. I know that our Lieutenant Governor, Sheila Oliver, be looking down on all of us, very proud of the work that's been done here. And as we miss her, but carry on her legacy, having the opportunity to invite all of you to join us in that legacy and building that future together is something that I know everyone on this stage holds quite dear. We had the opportunity to be a little extra brave with the LG around because she wasn't scared of anybody. And so when we wanted to do something new, try something that we believe was right, her answer was, go give it a try. And this is a room full of people who live that every day in their life and their careers. You have no idea the freedom that there was for us in government to know that she had our backs, and that if we said, give us $10 million and we'll see if we can make this work, she would make that money appear, and she would make sure that that program was successful, and she'd be out there trumpeting all of the work that you all do. So we've all had a long couple days. I don't want to keep you up here too long, but I do ask that we just take one moment, and I'm going to ask that everyone moving around stop for a second, take one moment to reflect on our Lieutenant Governor and her legacy, and be thankful that she was in the room with us as long as she was, and know that she will stay in that room in our hearts in the future. Moment of silence, please. Thank you all. And now I invite you to mark your calendars. Next year's 2024 Governor's Conference on Housing Economic Development will return on September 17th and 18th. We look forward to continuing the conversation then. Now we invite everyone who won an award today to please return to the stage for a final photo op, and then we'll let you all get back to your lunches.